And thanks a lot for the organizers to enable us to give this talk. And I will introduce you our Horizon project. And I also throw some materials modeling in the mix, and ontologies will be mentioned and discussed. As I'm a disseminator for this project for collective knowledge, and here you meet the team. So this is all the people I collected knowledge of, the work on this project, and I will share with you what we're going to do, because we're very young, we just started in November. So what is ontotrans about? It's a portmanteau of the words ontology and translation. And translation is a role and a process we worked out in the context of the European Material Modeling Council. And we can translate industrial problems into questions to be solved using modeling and simulation tools, for example, to create industrial innovation. Ontologies, we have, thanks to Samantha and Colin, heard a lot about already. We use a refer to the formalization of all relevant concepts, their meaning, their interrelation, and in our case, we look into materials, processes, properties, models, and characterization, and so forth. We also work hard on a general purpose ontology-based open translation environment, which we refer to as OTE, and we want to support the development of dedicated apps delivering a more smart guidance, and this is what I will talk to you about, so what are our plans. I have to introduce to you the translation process because it's familiar to us who work for a long time on these projects now. So the idea is there is somebody in industry that has a problem and you think about it, how can I use computational chemistry or materials chemistry to help them? So I translate into parts I can simulate. I build modeling workflows for them where I tell them what input is required, what codes are required, what's the raw output, how do I get to processed output, and how can I answer the question you asked me first place. It's very important to retranslate back from your modeling language into something your industrial partner can understand. The translator is a role, so there is no senior translator or principal translator you can find in a company. It's a role, and they can pick up these industrial challenges, transform them into modeling workflows, and guide how we can do these results. And it might be a consultant, it might be part of your R&D team. They are multi-professional, they know that they have a role, and they can understand both worlds, the modeling world and the industrial work. So they are polyglot, actually. They have to speak many more languages, and ontology will be soon one of them. A translator knows about industry. They know about how industry measures stuff. What's benefit management? How can I bring this benefit to you? I know modeling inside out. I also understand when there is a product, it has to go through a whole life cycle of industrial techniques before it becomes a product. I have soft and analytical skill. I can talk to people, help them. I'm helpful. Communication skills are very important. I know what project management means, that I can fit in somewhere. I'm neutral and sometimes software agnostic because I want to give my customer or my client the best solution, not the ones my software favors. And also, we want to have a track record of what we do, and we are really good people. We are very confidential. We know what's going on. So this is what we like, and we enter these companies and help them with our roles. So we start by understanding the business case. We understand the industrial case. I know about data. So this is what Samantha and Colin conveyed to us. It's very important what's there. I need to know what they give me. Are this data fair? How did they end it up in the database? What do I expect when I open this? Because we often need for our work experimental data to do validation and verification. When I have this in place, I start suggesting modeling workflows and let the client decide, because we're consultants, so we work with you and take the decision together. And once we're done, we translate our results back to the questions you have asked me first place. So this is what the person does with pen and paper. Now we want to get this translator in this handheld system, and there's a wizard, a software wizard, which we all know when we try to install programs And step by step, it takes us through to reach the end to install this program. We want now this step by step translation process. We get asked about the innovation case. What data do we have? What modeling do we want to do? And so forth. So how can I morph the translator with an open translation environment? And what about these ontologies? So let's see where this leads to. I show you a high-level overview of what we in this project want to develop. So you can see the translation case mentioned before is like a band wrapped around this tool. So we will have interfaces so our customer can engage with us. And we will have a heart, a core of this Ontotrans tool, where we have a semantic representation, and you will soon meet the Emma. We have knowledge bases there, recommendation systems, and metadata link us to a variety of knowledge sources. And this is where we get our data, our workflow, our knowledge, and hopefully create some wisdom for the person who has this innovation case at hand. Let's go a little bit into detail. We early on knew we need an ontology, and we have one, because what we want to do is we want a semantic representation of the innovation case. Like Samantha and Colin said, a computer can't do languages. We have to explain. So the ontology will be the DNA of our ontotrans, like your DNA stores certain things, then we make some RNA and get it back again. It would be nice if I get my case into a computer, computer understands it, and I get it out again with a nice answer to my problem. We have the EMMO. Let's go for it. The EMMO is the European Materials and Modeling Ontology. And we fought long and hard and decided this is what we need to do. We make a full-blown ontology. And you can see the ownership is with Emanuele Ghedini, Gerhard Goldberg, Adam Hashibon, George Schmitz, Jesper Fries, a conglomerate reaching from Italy up to Norway. We have a Creative Commons license that allows you to use it. Our field of application is materials and materials modeling. The language is OWL, which we heard before in the talks, and we develop with Protégé, and we have a reasoner, because we will come back to the reasoner in a bit. And our scope is represent materials, models, and properties. So when we look a little bit in detail into this in our ontology, in our EMMO, so you can see it lives on GitHub, so you can go there and have a look. And we really didn't shy away to make a proper ontology because we have a philosopher involved. So one of my team is a philosopher, and we have analytical philosophy involved about meritopology, semiotics, and logic. We can cover physical sciences, so we look into physics, chemistry, material science, and engineering. And we have reasoners, data platforms, and tools, because we also look into interoperability, which is semantic based. We can do materials and fields, quantum representation, multi-scale and multi-level modeling. We can do characterization and models, and we can define properties. And you see ISO standards popping up, because like Samantha says, there is some standards around, we cannot neglect, they are there. So they have to be part of it when you do something, you just can't invent something new. What about this part business? So you can see at the bottom, I have this beautiful Ferrari that can have a part which is a motor, that can have a part which is a cogwheel. And now I can say, well, I want to do some mesomodeling in. I can describe it in a mesoscale system. It can have molecules. The molecules can have atoms. And the atoms have parts that I can go down to neutron, proton, electron. So this is all covered in our ontology. And you learn now a new vocabulary in between. Our verb is has part. So when we look into the ontology, we have to think about real life. There is physical world where things happen. So there is this Ferrari, unfortunately not parked in my garage. My Ford has some cogwheels, I can offer these. And then you think, well, I have to get this into a computer. So how do I do this? I need to find a common representation framework to get from the physical world in the digital representation. Okay, so we have a holistic process to get there. I can work with reductionism, which we come back to. And then I have these properties and how are they determined? So there is a perceptual object as well. And then I have my concept, my metadata, and my data. So to look a little bit into details, the process of representing things by science is semiotics. And when we think about this motor again, if you give this to me as a modeler, I have to think and decide what should go into the ontology. So I have the easiest imagination is a digital twin. I could get a digital twin in my modeling, make the ontology understand that what it is, but it's a sign for the real motor. Those of you who are familiar to materials modeling, we can look into a metal part and I can say, if I take a particular metal structure and do some electronic calculations on it, that also can be a sign for what the machinery was to start with. It depends on the question you ask me. And then I say, okay, this is what I can observe, or I choose to postulate about what's going on in the machine. So you can see some branches of the ontology. It's really fully blown. We just show you some highlights and you can see the is-a relation. Of course, we have other relations that describe the parthood and so forth. And you must imagine such an ontology, if I drew it for you, would look like a spider's web. So we have interesting branches, the models and the properties to materials. I assign this. So I have here the semiotic branch with a sign, with an icon, with the model. But if you're philosophically correct, I also have the interpreter that does this. So that also has to be part of your ontology, what you do. We have materials classes, so we go physicalistic from perspective, we have meta, and then we have material. And this is when you then can say gold is a material, then it can enter our MO. We have multi-scale perspective, parthoods of material, and we have descriptive systems as well. So you have here metrological symbols for things you can measure, there's some units you can find, dimension, and so forth. This is some branches what we have. So the real thing is now pretty decently big. So how did we start this? So in 2016, this is when it was born with the European Materials Modeling Council, and foundations were laid in a new project with stakeholder involvement. Governments was taken, because you have to make sure when things are added, they are added in a correct way. We had the project SIMDOM, that was a digital ontology-based modeling environment for simulation of materials. Then you had application cases, so you could show how things work. Then we came up with the marketplaces. So we have here larger material communities that take part and infrastructures where the ontologies will play a role. And also some new application ontologies have been developed. And now you find our project Ontotrans, where we work on domain ontologies and industrial application cases. Another logo you may want to keep in mind is the OntoCommons logo. Yeah, because Samantha said, well, there's people really, really interested about this. And we have this everywhere, they're in industry, they're worldwide. And what you do is like you form an industry commons. So please keep the logo in mind, because we will pop up at your door if you're interested in ontologies at some point. And this idea is ontologies and tool foundations for data documentation in materials and manufacturing industry. This is the aim but other ontologies, higher ontologies and so forth are involved. And this runs until 2024, but it will go beyond because the idea is to just generate a starting idea. So you see our MO evolves quite nicely and finds a home in different projects. So now we want to bring the ontology to life because what we see is like these graphics you can see. So how do I work with them? So in our core of our software tool, there will be two logical components, which we call OntoRec for recommender and the OntoKB, which is the knowledge database. And we go in with RDF triple stores. So our Italian team has left no stone unturned. So we have a nice overview over every triple store you can have on the planet, what the advantages and the disadvantages are, and some was picked. So during the lifetime of our project, more and more development will be exposed. So it also should store knowledge, which means data with a meaning. So the idea is not only to use data which are already there, but populate with new data with different means and grow it organically. Then we have this OntoRec, which is meant to facilitate and standardize and control the access to this knowledge database. And we work with APIs or application programming interfaces. So they have to be written as well because you have to persuade your data to go back and forth. And also Sparkle queries will play a role here. The OntoRec entity will provide the main way to interact with OntoKB. So this is some course. Let's talk about RDF and triple stores. So we heard from Samantha already a good introduction about the research description framework developed by the World Wide Web Consortium. It enables automated semantic processing of information to structure it in the right way. I get a little statement with the subject, predicate, and object. Yeah. So we knew Samantha was allergic to juniper. So that I can learn, that shows me something. The triples are stored in a triple store. This is where they live. And this is a system framework that allows me to persistently store this. And these triple store engines support ontologies, which makes us very happy. They also can have inbuilt reasoners because when you have this ontology, you need to reason certain things and check it. And typically also come with application programming interfaces because I need to get into things. I need to put data, get data, and so forth. So the RDF is a graph data model, and we want to have a lot of them so we can query expressions that formulate paths through these graphs. And we find this better than expressing relation between cells and columns in a relational schema. Okay, some triples can be dangerous. So I chose one which you have heard before. I'm sure men are mortal. Socrates is a man. So the inference is Socrates is mortal. What's dangerous is if I start birds can fly. Then I claim a penguin is a bird. So maybe we should not infer anything. So we have first order logic here, but there's other orders of logic. And the beauty is you can change the ontology. You can add types of relationships and context. Its inference is flexible. Yeah. So you should not overdo it because you search and infer yourself to death, but you can change the rules by which you infer new knowledge. This is what you can, but with the birds, we leave it here and go not further. Okay, so OntoTrans supports the translation process in the following steps. I have this innovation case, which people tell me about in natural language. I have to formalize it in such a way that an ontology could understand it. I define the user case, KPIs, whatever is relevant for the business, and then I connect the user cases with my knowledge sources. Where do I want the wisdom from? Semantic results interpretation is a part as well, so I can facilitate sharing and reuse of user case. The reusability is very important because it saves us time. So we have an onto-translator ecosystem because you realize for one person to know all of this stuff, to dream in ontologies, build it semantically correct, do some API writing, it's a bit insane. So we know about this. So we want the classical translator to work with the end user to go from innovation challenge to the innovation case and help them with workflows. And we work with data scientists to build the ontology. So we get in experts to work with us together. Or the other way could, if an implementation is already there, then I can use a scientist to help them with solutions, with data analytics in a company, for example. Yeah? So we also have this role within the company. So you can see here a very crude outline what's going to happen. My user has a good life because he just gives me an input and gets the output he wants. Our life is a bit harder because we have to ontologize our innovation case, link it to OntoTrans, the core tools, and then we also need to work with knowledge sources. And as we are liking materials modeling, one could be a modeling process which provides the data backwards. But we also can work with analysis tools, with database. Yeah? So any knowledge source you can think about, name it, should find a life here. So how to get the innovation into OntoTrans? We have to do proper interviews and declare all individuals. So we need to speak ontology. So I ask materials used in a process. What happens during the process? Yes, you can imagine when you have metalworking, the things get heated, they get cooled down, they get bent and whatever. I need to know all about this. The production system and its component, is there some component in the production that does something to material? The products to expect it, the properties, user feedback. I mean, I could have a question by a user that asks me about marketing and if people like a shampoo that smells like apple. I can model that and give the answer if the user likes it. And then, of course, the modeling software, the sort of knowledge apps I use, and so forth. And here you see again, there is my car motor, how I get it as a signifier or representerman, as the philosophical speak says, as a digital twin into my computer or parts of it. And this is what I can store in OntoKB because this is happening in a language, an ontology, and the computer can understand. In an innovation case, we go with causality. So some things can cause something else. And this is a causality, but not a timeline. Okay. So you say my material object. What is my material? A shampoo. It smells, the apple smell. It has properties. It undergoes a process. I get a new material object with properties. Another one comes in. I have another process and so forth. I can bring, for example, observation procedures in. So you outline what happens, you learn about the taxonomy and you ask questions. So we have then forms the translator can easily fill in. Materials and process entities are represented as MO classes, they exist. You just have to annotate how the real thing relates to what is in the ontology. So then we also can process, yeah? So we have beautiful examples about reaction mechanisms we can describe, really good. And here is a delta T. So we have a temporal part. So a process is a temporal part of a physical. So one process has a second process or a third process and so forth. And then you can see our objects again. So we have this little cogwheel. I can model it, for example, with a continuum model. So I get this room shapes. I can assign properties to. I can use a Mesa model, atomistic model, or I go down into quantum chemistry. So each object has a spatial part, so they can be linked as well. So the innovation case may have different levels of detail in space and time. And I can express this by the mean of a parthood. So something has a part, that's the parthood. And this is called the reductionist perspective in the EMO. So the EMO would understand this and the computer then. So We have to build a wizard for our customer. So you know wizards, obviously, every time you install some software, that some graphical tool that talks you through different steps, you can go back, you can go forth. And I have to think about what does my user want to see? What do I have to expose to them? So it could be questions about the innovation case. I can ask them to make some decisions. I can go for a really interactive. I can let them make choices and selections. I also can have an expert mode and ask for more and give people more of a say what should happen, or I can make some tools there for specific problems only, can customize it or decustomize it as much as I like. And as we said, some people produce shampoo, so that would be in chemistry a formulation attempt where you find out what goes in the shampoo. Why does it sell? Because the people like the apple smell, or they like it smooth on your skin, or it gives you a particular experience, because we know experiential retail is very, very important. Sometimes the experience does more than the chemistry. But obviously, I have to ask a lot of questions to give my customer the expected answer. So let's look into Ontorec and OntoKB in action. So the Ontorec is the recommender, which can do inferences based on known facts provided by the user. It can provide me all inferences in the form of statements. So I also want to add them into the database. So if I found something, let me enter it, because then I can create a past query history. The database, the OntoKB, the knowledge base, is a dedicated database, and that will be our central hub for knowledge storage. Should be fast access to modeling solutions, so one has to find out how far things go to still make it feasible. So you want to get results in time, not search yourself to death. The data should be very interconnected, and everything we have on the open translation environment goes to this heart, to this core. Okay, so we want to collect, interpret, ontologize, and store information within this OntoKB, and it should be an ontology repository containing both knowledge, which we call semantic data, but also the system under which the data has been interpreted as knowledge. Yeah, so having data is one thing, knowledge is another thing. So you can tap into the OntoKB, and we have a team in Vienna that is developing the exploratory search system. Because when you have the Sparkle queries, also you do a good internet query, you have information. The more information you have, the better is the search result. But sometimes you know I want something, but I don't have a clear view. Or I require some support to discover new information, and now I just want to learn about the domain. So we are a bit unsure. And this is where we will come up with an exploratory search system, our ESS. It allows us to have open-ended, weakly defined information, seeking tasks like learning something, make some sense about, yeah, see what's there. And it can recommend related entities to current search results. And now we're in business, because if I have more information, obviously I can derive more knowledge, because I'm able to search better. So why are we doing this? So we want to modernize and establish the role of a translator, but also to support the usage of material, process, and product modeling in industrial R&D. So give them a process, okay? We also want to represent the manufacturing process challenge in a standard form. And the big, big thing is digitalization. So I need some standards to digitalize it, and so it's accessible to a lot of people. There is a language gap between manufacturers and modeling. We talk about modeling like I talked to you about atomistic models and electronic models and so forth. So what do I mean? What can they do? But we also can enable decision-making, because by providing tools, you can give certain decision-making some power back to the person that wants to make it. So they're not so reliant on you, but they get some feedback and some confirmation what the decision should be. We want complete solutions to industrial problems. we have validated models. So there's also a lot of work going on in the background to permit you validation and verification of the models and the tools who are in there, because you need to trust what's in there as well, what's under the hood. And then we're looking quite a lot with the open simulation platform. So we also have OSPs to permit interoperability between models and experimental data. So you can do this. You get an output, you can change it by hand, and then the next calculation can understand it and take it as an input. We're talking about dynamic and on-the-spot interoperability, where a machine must understand what's my next input. Then single useful workflows for specific industrial applications. So we have four case studies where we try to use a single useful workflow and give them something in hand where they can make decision and which also could be reusable for similar industrial applications. So you don't have to invent the wheel all the time forward. So this is what we're doing. And we are very young, so I shared with you some ideas how we see things. And what we're looking for is also you can become a stakeholder with our project Ontotrans. So come and join us, have a say, get information, put information back. You will probably come across, which I haven't listed here, onto commons if you want to go further and get industry and more stakeholders involved. And we also have a wider network in the EMMC that has an associated membership, which is free of charge. Everything what I mentioned here follows GDPR, so your data will be saved, and we only ask for what is necessary to let you have a share. And everybody is welcome. So if you have some interest, you can take as much and as little as you like if you wish to join us. So I hope I could give you a nice overview of what we do. As I said, early stages, a lot of ontology, a lot of ideas, and I'm quite happy to take questions if you have anything. Thank you.